All right, by now Americans are used to seeing obscenely huge sums of money spent to influence presidential elections. It's the same story with congressional elections deciding key House and Senate races. There's been $1.2 billion raised so far in the lead up to these midterm elections, but there is a third branch of government that has been increasingly targeted by outside spending, one that you've probably never thought that much about. I'm talking about judicial elections at the highest levels of each state, as in judges. Here's a closer look at justice for sale.
It was an emphatic ruling that reverberated far outside America's heartland. Iowa's Supreme Court voted unanimously in 2009 to allow same-sex couples to marry. And when just a year later, three of those Supreme Court justices came up for a standard retention election, that's just a yes-no vote to keep a judge seated on the court, socially conservative groups like the National Organization for Marriage made their dissatisfaction with the decision known.
If they can usurp the will of voters and redefine marriage, what will they do to other long-established Iowa traditions and rights?
Nearly $1 million of out-of-state spending poured into the campaign. All three judges lost their elections and their jobs.
87% of our judges in the United States have to stand for election during their career. And this is turning judges into fundraisers. And they're having to raise money from the very people who then appear before them in court. So the question increasingly is whether voters can be confident that justice isn't for sale.
38 states conduct elections for their Supreme Courts, either through contested races between two candidates or through retention votes. The remaining states use merit selections for their highest court. Since 2000, upward of 24 states have seen judicial spending records smashed. And in the last election cycle, totals reached $56 million, with nearly half of that coming from outside groups.
As a result, it leads to the problem of judges around the country having to look over their shoulder, essentially saying, well, if I make a decision that may displease people, maybe even outside of my state, with big money, then I may have to think twice about this decision.
Spending in judicial elections is sometimes driven by social issues like gay marriage, as seen in Iowa. But more often, business concerns dominate. Organizations like the Chamber of Commerce have spent big to create conservative majorities on state Supreme Courts, hoping that crucial balance of power will lead to industry-friendly decisions on issues ranging from employee compensation to Obamacare. A total of $2.2 million was spent this year in North Carolina, and so far, already $1.3 million has entered the Tennessee race.
Liberals control our state Supreme Court.
And while judicial election spending may pale in comparison to the hundreds of millions of dollars poured into congressional elections, experts warn a little money thrown at the courts goes a long way.
And there was someone years ago from the AFL-CIO who joked that it's a lot cheaper to buy a state Supreme Court than it is to buy a state legislature. Voter turnout in judicial elections is already low. And what that means is that an interest group can decide to pour in some money, turn out its base, and have a decent shot at tipping an election.
A recent poll found 9 in 10 Americans think campaign cash is affecting courtroom decisions. And perhaps even more chilling, surveys taken of state judges suggest that nearly half of them agree.
And if we get to the point where people think that judges are just politicians in black robes, then the special role of the third branch to protect rights and uphold the Constitution versus bend to the will of someone with electoral power has been turned on its head.
Are you kidding me? Half of all judges agree there's a problem with this process? Increasingly, national groups have made reshaping state Supreme Courts a priority. The Republican State Leadership Committee announced it plans to spend at least $5 million on judicial races this year in places like North Carolina, where more than half the state Supreme Court seats are on the ballot. As we've reported over the last few weeks, dark money has come to dominate political spending in elections, and judicial elections are no different. For every vicious attack ad accusing a judge of being soft on child predators or sex offenders, there's often a group behind it funded by unknown donors. And to Alicia Bannon, counsel at the Brennan Center for Justice, that makes getting money out of judicial races even more crucial. The Brennan Center is a nonpartisan law and policy institute out of New York University's law school. Alicia, good to see you. Thank you for being with us. I don't even know where to start with this stuff. Clearly, a bunch of judges don't like this because this could unseat them. That doesn't necessarily, that's not the biggest reason for this to be wrong. But there does seem to be studies that indicate that once you put a bunch of money into races, and people say, who cares about $5 million? I mean, given how much we spend. But in judicial races that nobody pays attention to, where there isn't fundraising, grassroots fundraising, $5 million is more than it needs to change the judicial makeup of a state.
That's exactly right, and that's something that special interest groups are increasingly recognizing, that with a pretty small financial investment, you have the opportunity to change the legal landscape of a state. And so that's what we've been seeing in recent years, that business interests on one side, plaintiffs side, trial lawyers on the other side, unions, have been pouring money into state Supreme Court races, trying to impact who's on the bench and ultimately the decisions that courts are making.
38 states, I believe, allow some sort of election. Either it's a competitive election or a recall,
or an up or down retention.
What's supposed to happen here? What was the point that this? I mean, on what basis would I, as a citizen, be able to make a decision as to whether a judge should come or go or run or not run?
Well, interestingly, judicial elections originated as a reform measure. So people were concerned that, judges were being selected behind closed doors. There wasn't any kind of public accountability. And so in the 19th century, states started introducing judicial elections. And then in the 20th century, we had states introduce further reforms, including these up or down retention elections as part of a merit selection system. What we're seeing now is money is becoming a bigger force in these races, though, is that the accountability mechanism is kind of breaking down, and instead judges are sort of looking over their shoulder. And, when I have a case before a judge, I want to be confident that they're going to be deciding that case based on the law, not worrying about who's going to be giving them campaign contributions or what the subject of the next attack ad is going to be.
Now, strangely, when you scratch the surface of dark money in politics in America, you don't often have to scratch too far before you see, oh, look, it's Karl Rove. What's Karl Rove's connection to all of this?
Karl Rove, back in the 90s, the first indications of the politicization of these state Supreme Court races was in the 90s in Texas and then Alabama. Karl Rove essentially orchestrated a campaign to push those courts in a conservative direction, to bring over a Republican takeover of those courts. That was the 90s. And then in 2000, you had a sort of greater expansion as essentially the tort wars became the court wars. And you started seeing more and more states become more politicized. Started to see more states have, other different special interest groups putting money into them.
He's innovative, if nothing else. Here's something interesting. A lot of this is supported by business interests, and in some cases, conservative business interests, but the attack ads don't generally speak about those business interests. They talk about being soft on crime. So there's a sense that once a certain amount of money starts flowing into a race, judges could change their behavior into being tough on crime, being pro-prosecution, so as to fight that perception off.
That's exactly right. There are some academic studies that have suggested that judges do change their behavior. So, for example, in election years, if you look at judges' sentencing decisions, judges tend to be harder on crime. And, judges themselves have sort of raised the alarm about the pressures that that these attack ads and the pressures of fundraising are putting on them. I think most judges don't want to be playing this role, but they feel they have no choice.
There was, in fact, this isn't just an academic discussion. There was a case in West Virginia where the CEO of Massey Energy donated a lot of money to the election of a judge, and that judge turned out to be the deciding vote in a case that was being brought against them.
Exactly. And that case went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, and the U.S. Supreme Court said that that judge should have stepped aside.
Yeah.
What's troubling is that even now, it's been 5 years since that Supreme Court decision, states still haven't changed their rules in terms of when judges have to step aside from cases. So, those rules haven't kept up with the flood of money that we've been seeing in these state elections.
What a remarkable story. Alicia, thank you so much for being with us. Alicia Bannon is the counsel for the Brenner Center.